a code that is a work of literature. Now, I was completely diverted from the project I was working on because that was so intriguing. Why would Stendhal have been motivated to read something like that to make his own writing more precise? Imagine Melville reading statutes in the middle of the 19th century in order to do a better job of writing Moby Dick. So the French Civil Code I discovered, I was completely sidetracked in the project I was working on. I didn't get back to that project until years later. But the French Civil Code, it turns out, is by far the most influential drafted legal document in the world. Latin American codes are based on it. Spanish, Portuguese, Italian, Greek codes are based on it. In the, what we used to call the third world, the overwhelming majority of codes, civil codes, are in either derived from or based on the French Civil Code. And it was drafted in 1800. In about 2 months, Napoleon wanted a civil code. And he picked four lawyers who were not revolutionaries, not part of it. They were not on the left wing in the French Revolution, but he thought they would do a good job out of professionalism. Essentially, he locked them in a room with a huge table at Fontainebleau, and the table's still there. It's an exhibit because it's a cultural treasure in French. The French language, anything having to do with the French language is going to be venerated. So you can go and see it. I haven't seen it, but I've seen pictures of it. They sat at this table, and in a few months, they drafted this thing. Those four were the equivalent of our Constitutional Convention in terms of influence over world code making and world law. And I promised Stanley Kowalski that I won't be able to pull off Marlon Brando. In all of Tennessee Williams, the only citation for legal authority. Did you ever hear Napoleonic Code, Stella? Now, what we've got here in the state of Louisiana is Napoleonic Code, under which everything that belongs to the wife belongs to the husband and vice versa. Well, the Civil Code of Louisiana is based on the Civil Code, indirectly on the French Civil Code, but not how you think. It was based on the Spanish version of it, which also inspired David Dudley Field to write his Civil Code, which it's not a total imitation, but it is in the same style. The Field Civil Code is the Civil Code of California, which has been completely obliterated by all the amendments that have been written by the California State Legislature in the customary style that we are used to. And it's almost like living in parallel universes. You'll read a section that's in the style of the French Civil Code, and there's an amendment to it, which is in the style that we are used to. And it's just, the auteur theory of law gets played out this way. You could tell who actually wrote this. Now, it turns out when you start looking at codes across international boundaries, you notice what happens. There are basically only three kinds of rules. Duties, that's what we love. We love to boss people around with duties and tell them what to do. Discretionary authority, you give people power or permission. Declarations, you create a legal state of being by declaring something. California exists because of a declaration enacted in Congress. It declared California to be a state like all of the others. New York didn't exist that way. The original 13, that's based on a contract. We all contracted. By adopting the Constitution. But declarations are underrated, duties are overrated. One of the faults of American statute making is the tendency to solve all problems with duties instead of relying on carefully created declarations. When you read European codes, the overwhelming majority of them are declarations. There are almost no duties in the French Civil Code. There are almost no duties in the German Civil Code. And the other two aspects that you need to keep in mind is contingencies, conditions, tests, exceptions, the rules will operate. Many rules are linked to an on-off switch, a test. Satisfy the test, rule operates. Satisfy an exception, it gets turned off. The other thing are standards, and standards aren't the same as tests. Anything can be subject to a standard. The quality of performance of a duty might be based on a standard. How much is good enough? For example, in contracts, best efforts or commercially reasonable efforts is a standard for how good the performance has to be in order to perform the duty. So, well-developed systems of legal rules are based on the interlocking use of all of these things. For example, Fred, if I were PERP and I had done something to violate something in the penal law, that would be a declaration. A declaration in the penal law declares the behavior that I have done as criminal and classifies it Class A felony, Class B felony, etc. That declaration alone does nothing. But if there's probable cause to believe I did it, now a whole bunch of other discretionary authorities and duties are invoked. Police can arrest me, prosecute can indict me. And if you succeed in getting a conviction, and that's a declaration too, your burden of proof is proof beyond a reasonable doubt. You satisfy that, the jury has a duty to convict me. The judge has a duty to pass a sentence, but he has discretionary authority about what kind of sentence it is. He sentences me to prison. Now the prison authorities have a bunch of duties. They have some discretionary authority, not all of which is recognized in the law. But being able to deploy all these things in a coordinated way is just essential to any kind of statute making. And legislatures are not. They really are. Basically, our legislatures just tend to throw ideas onto a table and hope that they will in some way coordinate themselves. We also rely over much on duties. And I'll give you an example. Texting while driving. Our solution for that is to just impose a duty, thou shalt not text. And when that doesn't work, raise the ante by raising the punishment. A better solution, in fact, might be to reduce some duties. Why do people text when they drive? Legislatures never ask this. They assume that people are obsessed with their devices. But actually, I don't think that's what the research shows. The research shows is that people are bored. They want to be stimulated. They're bored when they drive. Well, can you think of something that would keep them not bored and keep both hands occupied?
Listen to podcasts.
Nah, that's not going to do it. What about the hand? You know the answer.
Stick shift driving.
Oh.
A safety device that has been in every manufacturer at one time. In fact, every manufacturer does make them. It's just that some manufacturers don't sell them in the United States. Go ahead. Try to text while you're doing this. I live in Westchester County, and the other day I counted the number of shifts on the way. I come after the rush hour, and so this wasn't congested. 45 minutes, over 100 shifts. It's impossible. But the secret is, it's not boring. It's boring if the car doesn't engage you. That's the real reason why people are texting. They're bored. If you find driving interesting and not boring, then you feel no need to text because you're engaged in doing something else that's interesting. Andy Shepherd used to live in the same town I do in Westchester. He would drive a nice BMW and I would drive a beat up Honda Accord. He would arrive at work feeling kind of beat up by the experience. I would have had a good time. I had a good time. And in fact, Norm, Consumer Reports has excellent people who test cars. And if you read their reports, they will rave about any car available with a manual transmission because they enjoy driving them on their test track. And they cost about $1,000 less. So how about reducing some duties? Waive the fee on registrations, reduce the sales tax. making it revenue neutral, raise the tax slightly for everybody else, raise the fee slightly for everybody else, so now it's revenue neutral. And in fact, if you handle the money right, and then now you have some extra money left over for a publicity campaign. Save $1,000, pay less sales tax, don't pay any registration, and save this money, save that money, and maybe save your kid's life. It takes about 3 hours to learn how to drive a manual transmission. That 3 hours can save you a ton of money. And you could impose a slight duty, a minor duty on insurance companies. It won't matter to them. They'll just shuffle money around and have the same income, same revenue. They have to give you a discount if you have a manual transmission. It might be trivial. It's the symbol. It's the symbol that motivates people. Reducing duties in some situations can get you better compliance than increasing them. Right? We tend to believe that everybody's equal and we have to boss them around by telling them, ordering them around. And co-drafters don't usually think that way. Here's the way they think. And the leader of those four guys sitting at the table at Falcumbla in 1800, his name is Parthali, and he said, the two skills that you've got to have are foresight and simplicity. If you can foresee everything and simplify your solution to everything, you will have the most efficient law on earth. And that's what made the civil code the most influential form of written law in the modern world. We don't do that. We over-conceptualize. We totally over-conceptualize. We will find if there's a way of overcomplicating a problem, an American legislature will find it. And I'll give some illustrations if you want. That doesn't mean anybody's bad. Every legislator I have ever met has been conscientious, wanted to do the right thing, and was capable within the structure of the institution that person is working for. This is a situation where people with the best intentions are prisoners of an historical anomaly that has put us in a situation where legislatures don't have skills. Not legislators, legislatures. Part of the problem is that legislating has really two functions, and they don't require the same skills. One is creating law, coming up with it, devising it, designing it, using those three rules and the two permutations on them to get the most efficient result. That requires a skill set that is completely different from enacting the law. That requires political legitimacy. Professionalism is needed to create it. That's a professional skill. It's a skill that lawyers ought to have, but usually don't in the common law system. Professionalism can be counterproductive for those who enact. In fact, they have more legitimacy with the public they represent if they are not professional. If in fact their amateurism gives them a wisdom that the professionals don't have about what the public will accept and find as fair. Those are two different functions, and only in the United States and a few other common law countries are they mixed. Outside the common law, they are totally separated. The law is generally drafted outside of legislatures in consultation with the legislature. And the finished product is presented to the legislature, which can make some minor changes, and then they enact it. The French Civil Code, only about 7% until 2 years ago, only about 7% of its provisions had changed between 1800 and I think 2012. That is a long-lasting document. Now, there wasn't a legislature then. The legislature was in politics. But the drafters, the law designers, the law creators had a skill that we don't have in our system. Our system is totally chaotic. Those who enact are also expected to create, and it's not in their skill set. I don't know that we will ever get to the point where these two functions are going to be separated, since it is part of our political system that the public believes that those they elect should make the law as well as enact it. And I don't think, in our system, people don't generally recognize that those are separable functions. Now, and I should have passed this out. It'll work out this year, so. But if you want to see an example, two examples actually, of over-conceptualization in action. Now, what this is something from, oh, I should, I'm sorry, I didn't put you where, what happened after I said the foundation. I got obsessed with drafting. I read a whole bunch of other foreign law, some of which is British, UK, and some of which is in languages that I had to read in the translation, some of which is in Swedish, which I am able to translate even though I'm no longer fluent. And so where this ended up was a large article I wrote called Legislation's Culture, and there's two copies up here I didn't bring up, and this book, which was published about 2 weeks ago. And that took a long time because my co-author and I really had to plow some ground that hadn't been plowed before. And we had to, what we essentially did in the guise of a drafting book was to develop the ideas of what law ought to be, as well as how to draft the law better than we currently have. Now, what you've got in this handout is a few pages from the teacher's manual, which I'm working on now, and the publisher's annoyed with me because I haven't finished it yet. Plus two things from the book itself. One is this appendix F, which is the most subversive part of the book, and another is in chapter 16. But if you find that concept overload appendix, and you look at page 544, now, I just picked Illinois. I just took the seven largest states by population. I did a word count, which is easy to do. You just copy and paste into a word or word perfect, and then have them do a word count of the statutes in each state that define the degrees of homicide. And counted the words, and then just chose the state that was closest to the average, which turned out to be Illinois. Texas, by the way, is incredibly short when it comes to homicide. I think they believe that the population of Texas intuitively understands the idea of homicide very well. And I'm not kidding, you read it and it's admirably short. For some reason, they were not in concept overload. When you read California, California is even worse than New York. New York looks like it's overcomplicated. California, they're going to prove that they're better off in many ways than that's one. So, France, this is a teeny thing. Sweden, this is a teeny thing. Four lines each. Illinois, how many degrees of homicide do you really need? How many criteria do you need to separate one from another? These are not homogenous, crime-free societies. France is an immigrant country, and we know that there's conflict there. A higher proportion of the Swedish population is born outside Sweden than in the United States. Is not a homogenous society. If they can get by with these very few concepts, so can we. But we're not going to, because we instinctively try to find as many concepts as we can and incorporate them into every statute. Now, if you want to see that on steroids, go a couple of pages later. Page 547. Now, the irony here. Plain language statute. Left column. U.S. plain writing. Right column. Swedish. One, two. It's incredibly effective. I get lost in U.S. statutes. I can't understand them. Reading a language that is not my own and that I haven't spoken in decades, I can understand the statute easily. And in fact, when I was registered in Sweden, in any bookstore, you could find something that's about this thing, or you could then, and it's the code of Sweden. There are no annotations because there's no doctrine of precedent, which means that these statutes must be perfectly drafted because the courts are going to finish the job of legislature. You have to do it right the first time. In a minute, let's take a break. So, this one duty works, the one in the right column. All those duties in the left column all they do is add to federal employees' workloads, which means that it adds to our tax base, I'm sorry, not our base, but our tax liability, because duties are not free, concepts are not free, issues are not free. Every concept creates issues. If you can solve a problem with three concepts, and somebody else can't do it because they don't have enough skill, they can't do it in less than 10, your solution is probably cheaper. Every concept raises issues because there's going to be disagreement about how to enforce that concept. That's going to result in litigation. Those costs are going to get passed on to the public. It is part of the inefficiency of the system. When people look at European countries in which government does so much, like provide health care, free higher education, in fact, in Sweden they subsidize it. If you're a student in Sweden, the government pays you to go to school. It's a subsidy to make sure as many people as possible can afford to go to the university. They do it leaner because their statutes are simpler, their whole systems are simpler. I don't think anybody's ever gone into any European country and taken and estimated the cost, the monetary cost of all of the things that a government does there, and then compared it to the cost of how these things are provided in the United States. But in all likelihood, you know, we do it partially privatized. They provide many things through government that we don't. Their tax basis, their tax rates are higher. But the fact is they get more for their taxes, and it's because it's simpler, and because bureaucracies are leaner there, because they have fewer duties imposed on them. They don't have this kind of stuff. Every one of these ineffective duties you're paying for when you write the check on the executive. And the federal code is full of this stuff. When I was young, I had a job in the federal government, and it was just vivid the way everybody around me was oppressed by all of these directives to Congress about every little micromanaged thing they had to do. That's the cost of inefficiency with concepts. Every concept costs money because it creates issues, and those issues create compliance problems, compliance costs, and enforcement costs. Let's take a break for about 10 minutes.
It's about obligations. That's what it is.
Well, first, I don't know, have you had a chance to meet Karen? This is the gallery.
Nice to meet you. I keep seeing my
Did you?
Yes, I did, but I think it's okay.
Welcome. Thank you. Belatedly, I'm sure. Thank you.
Yeah.
First of all, your advice.
I need your advice.
Absolutely.
Good.
Right, so yes, that's fine. That's good. That's fine. Thank you.
I've stopped signing it.
Very good, very good.
Thank you.
Oh, yeah. I guess it's as long as it's, so it, as long as it's correct, it's not the press. Right, right, so then, yeah, then it's fine. It's just a referral, you can't do the duty, or you just ask them, so it's very considerate.
Just wanted to make sure.
Yeah, that's fine. Yeah, the one that we can't do is we can't require them to do that.
Oh, yeah.
That's part of the clock.
Oh, okay, it's part of the clock, right. Things are going well.
I'm a job over here. That's guilty of
is a declaration. It's a creative.
I prefer to go on the fuck up. It's a nice gig.
Yeah, really. Wow.
Yeah, well, that's a very good one.
Thank you.
Some expectations are maybe.
Well, that's an interesting thesis.
Yeah, he was so sweet. I told you. I gave him some advice.
Okay, would you tell? I'm sorry.
I told him that when he gets this job,
at Abrams,
don't be so shy. I said, you love that you have something to offer. And work hard. And feel good about yourself. Yeah. I said, you're a very smart young man.
He's adorable.
I really like him.
He's so smart. He's so adorable.
Yes.
Before I go back to my agenda here, I just want to point out something. This is a translation of the Swedish Civil Procedure Code from 1946. Translation was done in the late 60s. And this is a treatise on it. Here are the co-authors of both of them. Anders Brazilius, who was the Swedish judge, and Ruth Bader Ginsburg. These were her first publications. And the other justices still make jokes about her ability to speak Swedish and read Swedish law. But there's a simplicity to this that the two of them tried very hard to reproduce in English, and it was a lot of effort. It was hard for her because she was so used to the dense statutes we're used to. But she had to cross a cultural barrier, and Brazilius, basically she learned from Brazilius about how to do it. But this experience impacted her view of our law. There was, by the way, an oral argument in front of the Supreme Court, oral argument day late in November. Happened to involve two federal statutes, two different cases, and the word gibberish was used from the bench about both statutes, but she's too polite to say it. Others did. Now, there's a moral issue to this. There's a moral issue. If people don't understand their law, they don't trust it. And in the handout, if you look at page 7, this is the World Values Survey is something social scientists use. There's a standard form of the survey. It's carefully worded so that across cultural barriers you're going to get equivalent responses. And they do it in a rotating cycle. In the 2010-2014 cycle, one of the questions was, how much confidence do you have in your national legislature? Sweden, 60%, 59%, great deal of confidence. Not very much, 31, not at all, 7. US, 20%, great deal of confidence. Now why? It's because people don't trust the law. They don't trust it because they can't understand it. Now that big, thick volume, people would buy it the same way people here buy the baseball encyclopedia, essentially the set of disputes. They open it up in disputes around the dinner table or in a bar. Bartenders here have the baseball encyclopedia on the shelf and they get his book of records to settle arguments at the bar. Well, I don't think bartenders have that there, but people would buy this book, keep it at home, and if they had a question about what to do with the law, or if they were just having a friendly argument at dinner, they would pull it down and read the law and they could understand it. Now in the digital age, I'm sure that book doesn't sell very many copies, it's just the people over the age of 80, but now they just read the law online. It's that simple. It's that simple. And it's not that the law is simple. The concepts are cleverly, carefully designed to be accessible as well as efficient. Now, I know this seems bizarre. It seems like another world, a fantasy. You cannot imagine it. But that's because we are prisoners of this system. We cannot imagine lay people being able to read their own law and understand it. Now, these are systems that don't have precedent. There's no starting sentence in any of these systems. That puts a lot of pressure on the lawmakers. They got to get it right the first time. Now, we were talking during the break. I'm sorry, your first name is?
Oh, Andy.
Okay, Andy and I were talking. He's an antitrust expert. And in 1890, Senator Sherman was the floor manager for his bill. And, well, the senator from Ohio, he'll, you know the drill. And, yes, I will. The question was, what does it mean to have a, what is a combination restraint of trade? Sherman, it's his act. Shrugged his shoulders and said, I'm the faintest idea. That's for courts to figure out. Well, if there's no doctrine of precedent, it's not for the courts to figure it out. You've got to get it right the first time. And if you haven't, we've caused a lot of problems for everybody. Courts can't fix your mistakes. Now, it is possible to write law people can understand. In a moment, I'll show how the British are actually trying to do this. And you can't say that it's the English language. You can't blame it on the English language, which admittedly is convoluted. More convoluted than French, more convoluted than Swedish, but you can't blame it because the British are getting close to this idea. They're not as close as some of the continental countries, but they're getting there. All right, obstruction of justice. Now, in the handout,
this is going to go in the futures. I gave this as an assignment to students all for it. If you look at page 8, this is what's in statute now. Now, I don't know whether your copy is in color or black and white, but I did, in the color version, mark the subject of the sentence in red for the first sentence. And the verb is also in red, about 10 lines down. Whoever, blah, 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 shall be punished. Now, there's about 6 different crimes in that sentence. It's an older statute. It was enacted originally in the 19th century. It's been amended many times, but it's still incoherent. So on page 9, this is what would happen if you took a good drafter, you had him read the case law, you can redo it so that it could be easily understood and incorporated all the law, the gloss that the cases have put on the statute since then. Yeah, it's more readable. Can the public understand it? Not a chance. It's also inefficient. It actually has more concepts. I said here, it says the same number of thousand, because we had to import concepts from the case law, so the concepts are just growing. If you read the cases interpreting this statute, in fact, the courts can't restrain themselves. They keep adding to the tests. Now, if you try to reduce the number of concepts, that's what you've got on page 10. There's no reason why there has to be 4 different crimes and 2 different versions of each of them. Total of 8 crimes. There are only 2 crimes here. One is trying to corruptly influence a current proceeding and retaliating after the proceeding is over because you didn't like the result. Those are your only real goals, is to punish those 2 kinds of acts. The only question is how you define them, and the smallest number of elements make for the shorter trial. You could do it in 10 elements, but that's going to be a longer trial than a 3-element test. Because there are fewer issues, there's going to be less evidence. If you can find a way to solve it in three concepts rather than 10, the costs in society are less. Now, by coincidence, the next statute we're going to talk about, it happens to be particularly pertinent today. Since, it's a question of what's going to happen to Mueller. To get to Mueller, Trump is going to have to go through Sessions and Rosenstein. Sessions has recused himself, passed the responsibility down to Rosenstein. If Sessions had not recused himself, this is Trump's big grievance, then Sessions would be in charge, would be Mueller's direct supervisor, and could dismiss him. Now, in the statute, the solution is there. I'm willing to explain it, but I have to ask you. Don't tell me. I don't want to read this in the Times. And we're not seeing great lawyering in the White House now. In fact, we're seeing mediocre lawyering by people who don't realize that they're not very skilled as lawyers. If they haven't recognized this, I don't want to suggest it. But here are the holes left by Congress because Congress confused itself. Over-conceptualization doesn't just impose a cost on everybody aside from the legislature. It imposes a cost on the legislature itself. It takes more legislative effort to create complicated statutes than simpler ones among those who are elected. If this effort is shifted off the non-elected people who know what they're doing, they may sit at the table at Fontainebleau and have acts of geniuses, et cetera. But Congress confused itself, and here's how. Fourth line. If an officer dies, resigns, or otherwise is unable to perform the functions, everything else is triggered. How do people get fired in the federal government? Political appointees? Their resignation is demanded. When is the last time somebody was fired without providing their resignation? Now, this is a total lack of foresight because Congress knows this. They've seen it over and over and over again. It is exceedingly bad form to allow yourself to be fired without resigning. Yes?
Preet Bharara.
I'm sorry?
Didn't Preet Bharara refuse to resign?
Who?
Preet Bharara.
Preet.
He just got fired. Rhett Phillipson.
Yeah, you're right, but, you're right, there are occasional exceptions, but, yes.
Rhett Phillipson.
Right, we can all think of the exceptions, but tens of thousands of people were fired over the last 30 or 40 years in the form of a demanded resignation. Now, do you think Sessions is going to refuse? If Trump fires him, do you think he's going to refuse to write a letter of resignation? That's not in his personality. It's not. That's not him. It takes a different kind of person to thumb your nose at the president and say, no, you fired me. So one is the default option. This is what happens automatically if nothing else occurs. Number two is a possibility. Here's where the trouble is in number three. You can read this 20 times and you won't see it. It takes a Philadelphia lawyer to find a loophole. This takes 30 Philadelphia lawyers. It took me, I think, probably 40 times reading this over and over and over again, trying to figure out how to make 20. So, number three, the president may direct an employee. There are 11,000 lawyers in the Justice Department. After 4 years, they are eligible to be GS-15s. I don't know if anybody actually knows what proportion of them are GS-15s, but undoubtedly, at least the majority, if not the overwhelming majority, are GS-15s. So there's a large population here, and in let's suppose it's 6,000. He's going to be able to find someone to fix in 6,000. Maybe appointed by the president to act in acting capacity if, in the preceding 365 days, and that's all of the capacities there is, served in a position, any position, for not less than 90 of the preceding 365 days, and is currently a GS-15, subject to limitations. Now, here's where things get really screwy. This is where Congress made a big mistake. 3346. There are so many formulas here about computing the time. There are so many formulas. 210 days beginning on the date the vacancy occurs. That's A1. But the clock starts ticking again when the president nominates somebody. And the clock starts ticking again in B if that nomination is rejected. It keeps getting turned over and turned over. I don't understand how this formula works. And probably, I don't think anybody's going to know until the Supreme Court settles it. And if the Supreme Court takes a case like this, the Supreme Court's probably going to decide it 2 years after the dispute starts. In the meantime, somebody's going to keep serving and serving. But whenever this formula runs out, all that's necessary is to find out if you want to take the money of 6,000 or 7,000 or whatever it is. If you had gone back to the people who wrote this, the congressional committees in each house who were responsible for it, and posed this hypothetical, I'm sure their eyes would have glazed right over. They had no idea what they were creating because they confused themselves. But this really worries me. This really worries me. Mueller could be thrown out. And I don't know what Congress is going to do about it, but it could. I handed out a second packet. Because I've been working on the teacher's manual for this book right now, and over the weekend, I happen to be working on this part. The current style in some UK statutes is storytelling. And on the first page is the drafting guidance to their professional drafters on how to do it. Rule 1.1, telling the story. Take your readers by the hand and lead them through the story you have to tell. We're not used to thinking about a statute as a story. The fact statement in the brief is a story, but a statute is just a bunch of rules. But rules can be created as incidents in a story, and they have figured out how to do it. You might not like it, but they've done it. Look at the Modern Slavery Act. Now, section one here is just here for context. It's really got section two. 2.1, a person commits an offense if the person arranges or facilitates the travel of another person. He's not going to get a name. V, the victim, with a view to V being exploited. You actually kind of see action here. These are characters in the play. The Swedish statutes, by the way, are also drafted in something similar to this. But French statutes are, the style is the product of the Enlightenment. It's highly rational. It's Cartesian. Swedish statutes are a product of storytelling because there was a time, maybe 700 years ago, when virtually everybody in the country was illiterate, and each village would have its lawman, logman, somebody who was charged with memorizing all of the law. Now, the only way to memorize something like that, Homer memorized, actually, whoever Homer recited the story to, the kept amplifying on it. You could memorize a story, but it's really hard to memorize a bunch of words. So the original Swedish statutes were the form of a story. And you can still see that in some of the statutes today. You see people kind of acting. It's not as obvious as this. I don't know where the Brits got this, but they started doing it about 7 years ago. Now look at the bottom of page 3. This is the Anti-Bribery Act of 2010. This might have been the first time we did it, I'm not sure. Section 1, 1.1. A person, P, gets a name, is guilty of an offense if either of the following happens. Case 1, case 2, these are hypotheticals. And the elements play out in the hypotheticals. The whole idea is to simplify the law for the people enforcing it, but also to simplify the law enough so that lay people can read it and understand it. And if you go to the Parliament's website, they have these statutes there, and they make a big show of reassuring the public that they are drafting current statutes to the extent possible so that ordinary people can understand them. In France, a statute is considered well-drafted if a reasonably, French language, I'm sorry, if a reasonably well-educated and cultured person, culture is an important part here, can understand it if it's a statute of general application. Stendhal can understand his civil code. If it's a specialized statute, if a person who specializes in that field, stockbrokers should be able to understand, without the aid of lawyers, the French statute governing securities exchanges. And it's pretty much the same thing in Sweden. German statutes, if you loved Hegel, you will love German statutes. Those of us who didn't love Hegel can get a headache trying to read them even in translation. In some countries, for reasons other than ours, they have statutes that are convoluted, and Germany is probably the worst offender here. Our reason, historically, is probably this. We had lawmaking courts before we had legislation. Parliament is a Johnny-come-lately. And up until the beginning of the 20th century, judges, in opinions, in the common law world, not just in the US, but also in Canada, Australia, and the UK, they would, when they interpreted statutes, you can sense in many of these opinions dripping sarcasm and condescension. This is what the amateurs in Parliament came up with. The real pros are in the courts. And legislatures were treated as a sop to the public as far as the legal profession and the bench were concerned. Now, I'm not real, I may be simplifying, but I'm not exaggerating. In the French Revolution, the courts were swept away as lawmaking institutions, and I'll get to that in a few minutes, but in those systems, the courts take orders from the legislature. Here, we're never finished. Senator Sherman could trust that the courts, through decades and decades of interpretation, thousands of cases, essentially, could figure out what he hadn't figured out, what a combination of restraint of trade was. We have never really considered a legislature to have 100% of the legitimacy of law. We haven't done it. So it never has occurred to us that what legislatures produce is below a level of professional acceptability. As I said before, I have never met a legislator that I didn't like, so the Will Rogers of the legislature. Everyone I've ever met has been a conscientious person who is working really hard to do the right thing as that legislator understands the right thing to be. But they are victims of this system too, because they're able to achieve less of what they would like to do because it goes into a meat grinder and comes out as shredded up hamburger on the other side. Now, also in this, in the second pack, well, I had to throw this in because it's my favorite crime. I'll throw it in whenever I get into these type of statutes. It's on the fifth page. It's a criminal offense in Sweden, if you're a civil servant, not to do everything in your job description or to do things that are outside your job description. People get prosecuted. Police get prosecuted. Judges get prosecuted. And there are two grades. One is strict liability. The other is abuse of office. And these have been in statute books in one form or another since the 18th century. And there are permanent independent special prosecutors whose job is to prosecute only this crime. And one of them is in the executive branch. That person's job was created in the 18th century. The parliament, the Swedish parliament, got its special prosecutor in the 19th century because if King was going to have his special prosecutor, they want theirs too. But I just like to throw it in. Now, these things are useful not because civil servants are bad people, they are. But in these crimes, nobody goes to prison, even though that's a technical possibility. Even the worst thing that happens with most people is a trivial, who are convicted as a trivial one. That's it. The real punishment is the embarrassment. And there is something about statute making that I think is important in that lesson. You don't have to hit people over the head with dudes. Even slight consequences can have a profound effect on people. You don't have to have the Ten Commandments in every statute. Now, I promised the most efficient, to tell you about the most efficient legal rule in the world. Here it is. In the French Revolution, well, before the French Revolution, there was a system of courts with a doctrine of precedent. It's really true that there was a time in France when there was a vibrant doctrine of precedent. And no matter what kind of parliament, no matter what kind of legislature was created, regional or national, the courts would subvert everything that it did, everything that legislature did, in favor of the ruling class. Now, the National Assembly, the first parliament in the Revolution, wasn't going to stand for this, but they didn't have people who were qualified to be judges. They had to use the Ancien Regime's judges. They had to control them. And there was several different rules that were used to accomplish this. The most effective, I think, might have been by accident. Might have been created by accident for some other purpose. Here's the rule. The highest court in the country for non-administrative law cases, there's an administrative Supreme Court, and the highest court in the country is the Court of Cassation. It means the Court of Quashing. Its only power is to reverse and to remand, but not to remand for proceedings consistent with this opinion. There is no opinion, so there's nothing to do consistently with it. It's just up or down. The rule is the court's decision must be in one sentence, and the subject of the sentence must be the court itself, and the verb must be the court's disposition. Comes from a short menu. Reject the appeal, quash the decision below. There are about four other possibilities here. That's it. Try to develop a system of precedent for that. Go ahead. I dare you. It can't be done. Marbury versus Madison in one sentence. impossible. Brown against Board of Education, impossible. Levy against Virginia, impossible. Now, that doesn't mean those are bad decisions. Those are decisions courts had to make because of the inadequacy of the drafted documents they were dealing with. If the legislation and the Constitution solved the problems when it was adopted, when they were adopted, those decisions would have been unnecessary. We allow courts to do it because we don't mind, and they're finishing the legislature's job for it. But if you want to stop the system of precedent, that's a very efficient rule. Breaches of this, actually it's not a duty, it's a declaration of effectiveness. This is an example of how effective declarations can be. It's an ineffective decision. It has no legal impact unless it complies with this rule. There is no duty, but this court can't accomplish anything unless it complies with the rule. Now, there's an example of a decision. I just pulled it at random. It's on page 6. The subject is in red, the court decision, and the verb is in the last line, dismisses the appeal. If it's not, there's a corollary. If there are two distinct issues, on one of which there is the decision below is quashed and the other, the appeal is rejected, you get to have two sentences because it's virtually impossible to do that in one sentence. You're going to have two verbs. It's going to be too complicated. It's an extremely efficient rule. There are only three issues. How many sentences? What's the subject? What's the verb? Violations are going to be immediately obvious, and it's self-enforcing because nobody is required to follow a decision that doesn't meet those criteria. It's the most efficient. It's the most efficient rule. It is the one that makes it impossible for French courts to develop a system of precedent. Now, there is an anomaly here. This rule is binding only on the highest court in the country. It is not binding on the lower courts. So in the intermediate courts of appeal, the decision will be quite long. And the reason is because those judges are trying to persuade the higher judges that they were right. So they will explain in great detail their legal reasoning so that when the appeal gets here to the highest court in the country, it's going to be up or down, and there's no reasoning to explain. And the French Academy. The French Academy is really the highest court. French Academy controls the language. Yeah. Molly Bloom's soliloquy? Nah. This is about as far as it can get. It never gets beyond the longest sentence in verse, because it's not French that does. The acme of skill with the French language is to express a subtle idea in perfect French. If it's not perfect French, it's not entitled to respect. And if the French Academy says that they're not going to pass judgment on this, but if one of the principles that they enunciate is violated, and it's not perfect French, and it's very hard as an outsider to appreciate the effect of the French language and the standards that are imposed on the French language, this is why none of us will ever pass for French. I'll tell you a story and then I'll end. The story is my uncle ran away from home and lived in Paris for 11 years. He was among the first Allied troops in Paris in August of 44, and where people are celebrating the streets and carrying soldiers on their shoulders and throwing flowers at them. You don't recover from that. That's your entry into a city, especially Paris. So he comes home, takes the bar, finishes law school, takes the bar, and my grandfather made a mistake. He said, it's going to take him a couple of months to grade the exam. This was in the District of Columbia. They're a lot faster than New York. So go to Europe, have a good time, come back, and get sworn in and work at a firm. The last part was my grandfather's mistake. So my uncle goes over on the Queen Mary in August of 48, flies back in a Lockheed Constellation in September of 59. Mary Montalchevert, my aunt, their son Elaine, born, my uncle decides that for some reason he'd like to live in an American suburb when he raises his family. I don't know why, I've never understood. but fluent in French at that point, but he can't really be accepted because he can't do it perfectly. English is a very different language. We will accept all kinds of anomalies, people not doing it. There is no right way. There are a few wrong ways, but there's no real right way. Conrad can come from Polish and write beautiful literature. We will absorb all kinds of things in flex, and French is the exact opposite. You can destroy the possibility of a system of precedent through the French language, essentially through grammar, controlled by the French again. Okay, I'm done with my song. Any questions?
So I'll keep Q. Some of us might have to leave as we go. So, but Julie,
okay.
Go ahead.
Okay. Yeah. Thanks, which is really interesting. I have a lot of different questions, so I want to bore people with questions. I guess when we talk a little bit that civil code, the clarity and brevity of it is valorized, well drafted. And that this is something to be sort of admired. But actually, then you complain about the Sherman Antitrust Act and the Constitution, both which are actually short. And they're the briefest types of legal documents we have in our system. And the criticism is that they require too much interpretation. So is it a problem that if we had French people drafting those statutes, obviously it's French people, for example, or Swedish people, they would have been equally short but better drafted so that the courts would not need to interpret them. Because it seems to me the reason why the statutes are drafted in detail is because they don't trust the courts to interpret them properly, so it's a struggle for power between the courts and the legislature.
That is exactly right.
And so therefore, that's why we want, but then if we get shorter, then we need someone else to fill in the gaps, and then France and Europe, they'll use a commentator. So I'm not sure do we need to change the way we, can drafting really solve our problem, or do we just need to transport more power to non-legislatures to interpret, meaning either courts or commentators or some sort of authoritative institution?
I don't know, I'm kind of fond of the Sherman Antitrust Act, in part because it just, without serious amendment, it just grew and grew and grew. And you know, we were talking during the break, I don't think you can blame, it was the first, at least one of the first, maybe the first antitrust statutes in the world. And Sherman at least deserves some credit for trying to do something that hadn't been done before. And foresight, you know, the two great characteristics of a first rate law creator are simplicity and foresight. He couldn't possibly have had the foresight. But we're not going to make it better through the legislation. We let the courts do it. That sentence is pretty much, it's still the same exactly the way it's enacted.
Absolutely.
And that sentence.
The Sherman one.
That combination of restraint of trade.
Contract combination of conspiracy and restraint of trade.
Right. It has not been changed since 1890 because the legislature just figured its job was over. You're absolutely right that a lot of the overcomplexity in our system is because legislatures don't trust judges and they try to micromanage them. When Article 2 of the UCC is, other contracts teachers may or may not agree with me, but there are sections in it that are true masterpieces. Section 2-202, in one sentence, handles all of the law for the sale of goods, for the parole evidence rule, and the law of interpretation. That's a masterstroke. It took a genius to do that. And Carl Llewellyn, I think you got to give him a lot of credit for it, but he was not a legislator. And that sentence is exactly the way it was when he drafted it in the 1940s. But Carl Llewellyn trusted. If you read the Bramble Bush, he seems like a really arrogant, mean guy, but he trusted the better nature of people. And a lot of these European codes are based on the idea that if you tell people what's expected, they'll do it. And Llewellyn went around the country when the UCC, when Article II at least was first promulgated. And in the 50s, the early 50s, he spent a significant amount of time giving speeches in front of groups of people, encouraging legislators directly and indirectly. He gave a speech to the Tennessee Bar in which he said, you've been bamboozled by law schools to believe that you've got to write a statute to tell dumbbell judges. Now, that was his phrase. I said bamboozled, but what he said, dumbbell judges. To order dumbbell judges is what to do, and you've got to learn how to trust them. And I think that is part of the problem, that the war, the subtle war that went on for a very long time between Parliament and the royal courts, and in this country between judges and the legislature, and you can find in many, in the place where you're most going to find that in state law is usually in interpretations of state constitutions. I know this is a boring subject, state constitutions, nobody ever pays attention to, but there's a lot of really interesting case law in state constitutions, about state constitutions, but there is a very subtle struggle for power in which the courts are resisting encroachment from legislatures. And I think you're exactly, it's absolutely right that this is micromanaging to prevent courts from getting power, or from regaining some of their prior power.
But just as quick, but you think we should trust the courts more than that? Because it seems like that's a consequence of the shorter version of
that. I don't know, I'm kind of like Llewellyn. I think that people will do the right thing if you help them do it. It's like the manual transmission. People will do the right thing if you help them. And if you give them a, if you actually reduce their duties, they might actually enjoy saving the money and driving. They wouldn't be feel beat up by the commute the way Andy did. And they might enjoy the commute the way I enjoy driving to work today, even though it was the end of the rush hour. But we tend to look for ways when we enact statutes of bossing people around. Legislatures try to boss around courts. They try to boss around the public, and there's a price for that. There's a limit to which people are going to put up with. And I think it's often more effective to trust, to come up with a simple solution that people feel comfortable with. And there, I think that's one of the biggest problems we have. But I do not pretend to have any kind of skill in that area. So, yes.
Thank you,
Karen.
I want to say something about the Sherman Act, because the Sherman Act was amended two times afterwards because there was a problem. The courts were interpreting it to prevent, very much more conservative than the legislator at the time, to prevent unions and employees from engaging in protected conservative activity. They were suing them, the labor disputes, they were enjoining them, they were convicting them. The problem was the legislature had to amend it to exclude labor disputes.
Right.
And so it wasn't.
Right. What was that, Section 4?
Section 6, actually.
Yeah. Right, okay.
And so it did require legislation to protect employees, and the problem then became that if they excluded labor disputes, it was so, it was really a benefit for unions, so that, you know, the Wagner Act, 1935, which was a lot later than the Sherman Act in the 1890s, I think, they provided so much freedom for unions that later on they had to amend it, legislature had to be amended to preclude secondary boyhoods, mm-hmm. in 1959. So here you have a situation where the legislature was actually, I think, benefiting us from this. The Sherman Act could have been applied to anything. So to me, that is a problem.
But I think the problem there is the lack of foresight, and the words were not carefully chosen. But I do need to say something about antitrust law and competition law. You used the Chow book, right, in IDT?
Yeah.
And the EU competition law. Do you have the mental meltdown I do when you have to teach that part of the course?
Yeah, I have that a lot of times, but yes.
The EU, and you probably noticed this from newspaper reports about how Microsoft gets in trouble, Google is getting in trouble. It's not just privacy, but it's also combinations, what we call combinations of restraint of trade. They consider it to be competition law. We have this nice short little statute and a huge amount of case law. The EU legislates through regs. They call them regs. They're not administrative regs the way we think of that.
they have, you want to talk about concept overload. This is where the Europeans, it's a complete role shift.
And some of them are French, too.
Yeah. but you read these things, and I don't know, I get a headache. I take Advil before I try, because it's happened to me over and over and over again. They are incredibly complicated. There are exceptions to exceptions to exceptions to exceptions. I'm not kidding. There are four different layers of exceptions for some of these things. Yes?
Yeah, just to add one thing to what Karen said. So just with respect to the Sherman Antitrust Act, because it's so plain, contracts, combinations, or conspiracies in free trade, one would argue that the law was misapplied to labor unions, because it was supposed to be about big business.
Right.
So when you have combinations in restraint of trade, which essentially are labor strikes, you have to delete that concept, and that's what led to Section 6, which is to say that the labor of a human being is not a commodity, and therefore it's self-exempting from the Sherman Act.
But that was an example where the fact that it was so general was not a good thing. Mm-hmm. It would have been better had it been more specific. I have one other point I want to make.
Yeah.
I watched Bill Maher, one of my favorite shows. It's very liberal if you watch it. But people today are feeling, and you tell me what you think about this, that there's a corruption going on because of Citizens United and this PAC money. I don't know, this is beyond your, and this is the political view. The PAC money is being given to legislators and lobbyists are really drafting all our laws for the drug companies, the tax right, the tax code. It's a political issue that I think it's not that all legislators are so perfect.
By the way, what's legal under Citizens United is a crime. It's an European country. Parties can raise money only through limited means, and each country will have a list, and it differs from country to country, and some countries are not strict about this. But the party cannot acquire money in any way other than dues and a few contributions above board and things like that. And advertising during campaigns is strictly regulated, even in the UK. These aren't just illegal, they are crimes, and they're serious crimes. The Citizens United is a definite problem.
So they're making the statutes more complicated purposely. They're being drafted by lobbyists, for all these different, maybe it's the hedge funds for the tax code, it's the pharmaceutical companies.
I should have brought myself up because of all U.S. statutes, the tax code is the one that is just off the charts. In Sweden, most people file a tax return by sending a text message to the government. You can download the app. It's in the App Store. The problem is you can't get past the second screen unless you have their equivalent of a social security number. But there's only one deduction that a significant number of people take. It's based on commuting. If there's public transportation, it's a formula. If not, it's based on distance. Their computer knows where you live, knows where you work, and their IRS knows everything that our IRS does, all your sources of income, everything else. So they send you a proposed return. You like it, you take out, you download the app, you push a few things, and it can take you 5 minutes to file a return. That's it. Now, how much time did it take? Is it going to take you in April to do your return? I don't know, if it takes me about 3 days. Now, I have two Schedule Cs, I have these ones before. It really does. You tabulate everything. Schedule Cs eat up two of those. An entire day just to do an ordinary 1040, even with TurboTax. They don't like TurboTax. There is no TurboTax. There are no tax accountants. It's all simple. And every year there's their version of Gallup poll among their questions is, what do you think of certain government agencies? There's a list. Do you remember which one comes up one or two every year? Their version of IRS. People laugh when they file the return because it's so easy. It's like a joke. And they know, they all know what we do. And they feel sorry for us. It's complicated in part because complexity allows people to get away with things. The lobbyists have built essentially a Christmas tree for themselves into the tax system. And there's no way to stop them because we have no standards of what is too complex to be enacted.
there's no point at which we say, that is too complex, we will not vote for it. That's, I forgot to mention the Grandmont test. You know, in the hard sciences, especially physics, it's not a common, the saying is, if you can't explain to your grandmother, you don't understand. Well, maybe the test ought to be, if you can't explain this statute to your grandmother, don't vote for it. There has to be a benchmark of unnecessary complexity. Where we just enact something and we tell them to go back and do it again. I don't know what that benchmark would be, because we have different kinds of grandmothers, but. But there really is no way of restraining it. And you were right that because political contributions can corrupt the system, we're defenseless. The tax code, virtually everything becomes overcomplicated. Now, if you wanted, if you were the Trump's lawyer, you wanted, with foresight, this was from 1998, if you wanted to create the means of doing what you wanted and bamboozling everybody so nobody would understand what you were doing, this is the statute. Hidden in those things are real bombshells. Okay.
Thank you.